All right, so tonight's topic, turn your husband into your soulmate. My husband is a rabbi, and he, sometimes marries people, and when I meet with them, the couple, I often meet with them two or three times before the wedding, and they think they're meeting with me in order to learn about the wedding ceremony, which we are going to go through the hows and the whys. And again, we mostly deal with Jews from all walks of life, but some of them have been a little bit far away in their time. But really, I don't want to talk to them about the wedding. I want to talk to them about marriage. A rabbi in Toronto once said, if only people spend as much time planning their marriages as they do their weddings, we'd all be a lot better off. My first session with them, I call Scared and Straight. Now, I don't tell them that, but in my mind, first session, Scared and Straight. So what do I say to this young, naive couple in front of me? I ask them, of all the people walking to the chuppah, how many get divorced? So what do they say? 50%. And then I ask them, of the 50% who stay married, what percentage would you say have a happy marriage? What would you say? 10%. 50%. 25%. In a married audience, no matter where I speak in the world or what language, in a married audience, I get what I just heard, which is of the 50% who stay married, that the lowest is usually about 10%, and the highest is 50% in terms of what percentage would you say are happy of the 50%. I was once the keynote speaker at an NCSY Shabbaton in Michigan. It was me and 120 teenagers. It was very special. And one session I had was on the Ten Commandments, and I got to number 7, don't commit adultery. So what am I going to say to these kids? So then I asked them this question. I asked them, of all the people walking to the chuppah, how many get divorced? And they said 50%. And then I asked them, of the 50% who stay married, what percentage would you say have a happy marriage? Who are they thinking of? Yes. You know what they said? 1%. 2%. They were joking. And I thought, if their parents could be here, they'd be scared straight. So I say to the couple in front of me, let's be very generous. And we'll say, of the 50% who stayed married, 50% of them are happy. And we're being very generous. That means, of all the people walking to the chuppah, maybe 1/4 are going to come out with a happy marriage. So I say to them, you don't want to be a statistic. Now let's learn. And I share with them some of the wisdom I'm going to be sharing with you tonight. And this is the wisdom from our Torah. And I've extracted the wisdom and the experience I've had, of course, both in my own marriage, but of the many hundreds and hundreds of couples who we've been involved with from all walks of life. So the first thing I say to the couple is, we have to define our terms. The Torah is very big on this. You want to be happy? What's happy? You want to be successful? What's success? So first, we have to define what love is and what marriage is. Because sometimes what I do when a couple comes to me, unfortunately this happens on a weekly basis, and they're having trouble in their marriage. One of the techniques I use is I give them two pieces of paper, and I write, and I say to them, write down your definition of love and your definition of marriage. So the guy writes, love is, marriage is, and she does the same thing. Then they hand me their papers. What do I see? Two different definitions. Hello. We're in this together, and yet when we define what we're in together differently, how can we possibly achieve it? At the very minimum, we have to have a mutual definition of what we're in. Now, when I was first teaching about this, I defined love, and then I defined marriage, which seems like the right order, right? Love, marriage, baby, carriage. And then I realized, no, Lori. Anybody here who's been married for a few years, and you go to a wedding, you go to a chasana, or you go to a shavuot brachas, and the chasana kala, the bride and groom, talk about how much they love each other. I love you. And you're going, yeah, I'm right. You and your husband are like, they don't know what love is. You can't compare the love I had for my husband on our wedding day to the love I have for him now, almost 30 years later, 5 kids, everything we've been through together. That was like a joke on our wedding day. I knew I was onto something, but come on. So you can't define what love is. First, you have to define what marriage is. Now, the Jewish definition of marriage is very easy to remember. It's oneness. Echad, one. It says in Kabbalah, before you're born, you're one soul, one neshama, and Hashem splits you. You're half a soul, and you go off into this world, and your other half, your soulmate, your zivug, also goes off into this world. And hopefully, you make choices in life, and you make good choices, and you merit your besheret. You merit to meet your soulmate. But if you imagine your neshama, your soul, is like a circle, the Almighty does not split you like this. He splits you like this, like two pieces of a puzzle that fit together. That means you have qualities that he needs, and he has qualities that you need. Because the whole idea of marriage is you're going to realize your potential through this union. And the mistake that people make is, I should marry somebody just like me. How can you realize your potential if you marry somebody just like you? It's just more you. I was in Los Angeles a couple of years ago, and I was speaking there, and I was staying at a friend's house, and they said, listen, we have this friend, he's a longtime bachelor in the community, he doesn't seem to be able to get married, will you please speak to him? Give him some advice, coach him a little bit, like, we don't know what to do. I said, fine, as a favor, I said, fine, the guy comes over. Nice guy, handsome guy, successful guy, longtime bachelor. So I said, okay, tell me about yourself. So he started describing himself, and then I said, okay, well, tell me what kind of girl you're looking for. Guess what he described? Himself. And I said to him, you know, you just described yourself. He goes, I did. And I said, it's nice that you like yourself so much, you want more of you, okay? But maybe this is your issue, all right? That's why opposites attract. Extroverts tend to marry introverts. People who organize in detail tend to marry people who are more artsy and flighty. People like the thermostat up, marry people who like the thermostat down. Why do opposites attract? Because you're half a soul and you're yearning for completion. But here's the mistake we make in marriage. Those same qualities that we were so drawn to in the other person that complete us are the same qualities that later on in marriage make us nuts. Why can't you be more social? Why can't you be more on time? Why can't you be more fill in the blank? Ladies, instead of resenting those qualities, embrace them. Those are the qualities the Almighty says that you need in order to realize your potential. Ladies, you marry your homework. And listen to the insanity, okay? You notice you never fall out of love with your kids. Do you ever like have one and you call it Jewish Family Services and you just, what kind of, I fell out of love? We never fall out of love with our kids. And is anybody here pregnant, wants to announce they're pregnant? Pregnant? Yes, pregnant. What is your name? What is it? Mazal. Oh, beautiful. So is this your first or it's your fourth? Okay. You're going to love your baby? How do you know? What, you love every baby? Some babies are bright, some are babies. Mazal, how do you know you're not going to get one of those? Why is every pregnant woman, if I ask you to love your baby, she's like, of course. She's insulted I even asked her. Why? Why does every mother know she's going to want her baby? Because she made a choice, even before the baby was born, that she was going to let that baby, no matter how the baby comes out, boy or girl. Organized, or burying the shovel. Athletic or theatric. Quick to anger, easy going. It doesn't matter. Why does every woman know she's going to love her baby? Because love is a choice. Love is a choice, and what is that choice? Okay, so let's move on from marriage. So marriage is oneness, okay? Marriage is oneness. What is love? You know, before I move on, just this whole extrovert-introvert thing, is anybody in the same dynamic of a marriage that I'm in? I'm the extrovert, and my husband is the introvert. Is anybody like that? Anybody got that? Got that? What is your name again? Heidi? Okay, so when you go into a social situation with your husband, you're the extrovert, right? Okay. When you go into a social situation with your husband that he doesn't want to be at because he's an introvert, what's the first thing he says to you before you walk in? He doesn't say anything. He's so introverted he doesn't even talk to you. You know what my husband says? Because for an introvert, going into a social situation is like sucking the air out of the room. It's a blank spell. For an extrovert, going into a social situation is like pumping air into the balloon. It gives them more energy. I got up at 3:30 a.m., ladies, to come here, okay? 3:30 a.m., yeah, thank you very much. I live in the Washington, D.C. area, and I had to catch an early flight, and I have these, whatever, and I'm going to be up to, and tomorrow I'm flying off to Israel. When tonight, you think I'd be crashing? No, I'm going to have a hard time falling asleep tonight because I'm hanging out with all of you, all right? Really, and I get more energy the more I'm with people. All right, so introverts marry extroverts, and people who are organized marry people who are, it's why? Because the Almighty is saying, for every pod there is a lid, okay? There's a Jewish expression, all right? That there's two pieces of a puzzle that fit together. That you're going to become a greater person by marrying this person. You're looking for, and when you're guiding your children and who they should marry, it's not what you want, it's what do you need? What do you need? Somebody came over to me and they asked me, you know, what questions do you ask when you're calling around about your building to match your kids up? And I said, what questions do you ask depends on your kid. What does he need? What does she need? Those are the questions you need to be asking because you're looking for, and you're not looking for, the perfect person. You're looking for the person perfect for you. And the person perfect for you and the person perfect for your child is an imperfect person. Everybody has stuff. Have you noticed that? Women come to me like, I'm going to get divorced, and then it tells me I want this guy, and he's just like, I want to get with this guy, and I go, okay, you get divorced. I said, you want to get married again? They're like, yeah, of course. I go, you know the next guy? He's not going to have that stuff. But guess what? He's going to have other stuff, okay? Because everybody has stuff. At least this is known stuff. Now you have unknown stuff, all right? When we have to deal with our husband's challenging qualities, with his stuff, okay? What do we have to be drawn upon from ourselves? Because we don't grow through our husband's good qualities. I hate to break the news to you. Our husband's good qualities are like the whipped cream on the hot chocolate. Extra yum, yum, yum. We don't grow through our easy kid. We grow through our challenging kid. When we have to, and this world, ladies, is all about growing. It's all about realizing our potential. And the Almighty sent you the guy with that stuff and that challenging kid to make you a better person. When we have to deal with our challenging kid, or we have to deal with our husband's stuff, what do we have to draw upon within ourselves? We have to be patient and understanding and being a giver and being loving and being supportive. If I told you I have a patient, kind, loving, supportive, giving person for you to meet, you'd go, oh my gosh, can I meet that person? I want to meet that person. That sounds like a great person. Get it? The Almighty is trying to squeeze the potential out of you and me and brings these people into your life, the challenging people. Some of them have in-law after their name. In order. Our son just got engaged. And it's our first getting married. And he's, I don't know if anybody are familiar, there's another speaker of the Jewish Order, his Neely Cousin. She's also a leader of the JWRP. So my son has married her daughter. And their daughter, this is their first, you know, like also married pop, and so nobody knows what they're doing, it's perfect. And so I was away at Pesach time. I'm like one of those speakers, those fancy Pesach getaways. So this year we were in Phoenix, we were Rabbi Wallerstein's Ornava program, Charlie Rohrer was there, it was great, okay? So, of course, and my son had just gotten engaged in Erev Pesach, so I'm walking around, like there's 800 people there, four people there, and I walk around going, like, mother-in-law advice, okay? So the general theme of mother-in-law advice that I got was, mouth closed, purse open. Life, this new dynamic, and I'm growing. I'm already growing, and I'm really being careful, and I want this to be fantastic and amazing, but I know it's challenging, and better to learn from other people's mistakes and not your own mistakes. So I collect wisdom. I collect wisdom on airplanes. I don't care who's beside me. How did you get through the teenage years? What's your secret to this? What, if you had to do it over again, what would you do? Tell me something you did wrong. Right? Collect wisdom. And if you ever want wisdom about anything, it should be about the most important relationship in your life, and that is your marriage. Making the choice, the right choice, and when you're advising your kids, this is the most important decision they will ever make in their lives. The right decision will propel them forward in life, and the wrong decision, destruction. All right, so marriage. Marriage is oneness. What is love? What is love? So there are three aspects to the definition of love. So one that we've touched upon already. Love is the emotion that you feel when you focus in on the virtues of another person and you identify them with those virtues. That's love. I'll repeat because it's so important. Love is the emotion that you feel when you focus in on the virtues of another person and you identify them with those virtues. You see, we do this with our kids. You ask me, like, tell me about your kids. I'm like, oh, my children's like this way. Tell me my children's like this. Okay. So I'm not just a bragging Jewish mother. This is how I see them. Even though, who knows my kids' good qualities better than I do? Nobody. Who knows my kids' challenging qualities better than I do? Nobody. But when I think of them, I identify them with their good qualities. That's what we're supposed to do in marriage. Remember, love is a choice. I'm choosing what? To focus in on his goodness. Everybody's got stuff. What are you choosing to focus on? It doesn't mean you're blind to their negative qualities. I'm completely cognizant of my kids' challenging qualities, but I love them because I choose to focus in on their goodness. When are we supposed to choose to focus in on our spouse's good qualities? Every day, every hour, every minute. If I focus on my husband's stuff, I won't feel love. If I focus in on his virtues, I will. It's really that simple. Love is a choice. So choose wisely. That's the first definition of love. The second. So love is, what's important to you is important to me. I learned this from David Weiss. He was the head screenwriter on Shrek 2. I spoke with him at a conference in London, England. I also spoke at a conference in Istanbul with him. And he had a whole Jewish journey. He's got a whole story. So David Weiss learned this from his rabbi, who learned it from our rabbi. And he said this was the theme of Shrek 2. And if you read Shrek 2, okay, you'll see. The theme of Shrek 2 is, what's important to you is important to me. Now, I learned this from my parents. Talk about opposites attract, okay? How can I describe my parents to you? My mother's idea of a great vacation is backpacking in Nepal on 24 hours notice. She's 82. I'm not joking, all right? She's adventurous. She's creative. She's spontaneous. She's impulsive. My father's idea of a great vacation is an air-conditioned bus tour of Miami. He's been planning for 6 months. Got it? They've been married this year, 6 years. Okay? I'm actually a very interesting combination of my parents. I have a very adventurous side from my mother, a very practical side from my father. How did they make this work? They live this definition. What's important to you is important to me. My mother, she loves the arts. So they have a subscription to the Toronto Symphony. So once a month, my father goes with my mother in Toronto to the symphony, holds her hand, and tries not to fall asleep. My mother, my father, he's a real Canadian guy. He loves hockey. So my mother goes to the Toronto Maple Leaf hockey games with my father, holds his hand, and tries to pretend this is not stupid. Because love is what's important to you is important to me. Our son Moshi, who just got engaged, okay? So Moshi's our jock, okay? He's like totally into sports, and he always followed sports. So we didn't raise our kids with television, but when I would travel to speak, I would always turn on ESPN. Why? So I could come home and say, Moshi, I saw Shaq, and his neck is like this. And I saw Kobe and all his tattoos. And I saw the mailman. You know why we call him the mailman? Because he delivers. I know this. So when I would tell Moshi this, Moshi's eyes would light up. Why? He knows I don't love sports, but I love my Moshi. And love is, what's important to you is important to me. The third aspect of the definition of love is from Rabbi Dessler's work, Strive for Truth. He asked the classic Jewish philosophical question, does loving lead to giving, or does giving lead to loving? I love you, so I give to you, or the more I give to you, the more I love you. And the Jewish answer is, the more you give, the more you love. You see this with kids. You see this with kids. I don't know about you, they handed me my first kid in the hospital, Shoshana, and I was so overwhelmed at how helpless she was. Babies are so helpless, they're so tiny and so helpless. They can't do anything on their own. They can't feed on their own, they can't clean up on their own, they can't turn over on their own. You have to burp them, they can't even burp on their own. Why did Hashem make the world this way? Hashem designed the world with unbelievable brilliance and unbelievable wisdom and lessons for us. In the animal kingdom, it's not like this. A deer has a fawn. The fawn nurses a little bit, is a little bit shaky, and goes, has a life. Babies are so helpless. Why? So we'll give, and we'll give, and we'll give, and we'll give. And what do you get back for the first few months? Oh, you get something back. Yeah, the first smile is gas, okay? But we'll take it. You get something back. You get throw up down your back, diarrhea down your front, and sleepless nights, and you love this baby more than life itself. More than life. I have to tell you, when I left the hospital with Shoshana, there should have been a siren that went off that, like, mother who doesn't know what she's doing, okay? A couple of years ago, one of my kids was going through a little bit of a hard time, and we had this plot, okay? We're gonna adopt a dog, okay? Okay, it's not so done in whatever in my circles, but we just thought it would be good for this kid. My husband, we didn't tell him because we completely against it. So I don't know if you've ever gone through this, but we literally went online. We figured we'll get like a dog that somebody threw away. Like a fox that will save the dog. So if you've ever done this, you go on and you want to apply. It's a long application about your history with animals and your kids and your what does your yard look like and if you have a fence and you've ever had a dog and everything. We were rejected by every organization that gives away dogs that people threw away. If you get past the application, they come, they interview your neighbors, okay? It's unbelievable. But because we didn't have a history with dogs, and because we didn't have a fenced-in yard, thank God they rejected us, because my husband would have told me, okay? They let me leave the hospital 5 times with a human being, okay? With no interview and no questions. You have your car seat and your dog, okay? And that's why my husband and I spend a lot of time cleaning up the mess with adults, okay? Because our parents, your first kid is like the first pancake. Okay, now we get better, okay? Now you're about 3 kids, you start catching on. lesson Hashem gave us with our babies. You want to love somebody more? Whether it's your husband, or it's your neighbor, or it's your mother-in-law, give. Don't wait to feel love and then give. Give, and you will feel love. All right, so those are the three definitions of love, and we define marriage. Now I'm going to lift out of my dating workshop, which this is not, the three questions you have to answer yes to in order to know it's the right person. For those of you who are trying to get married, and for those of you advising people, like our children, again, the most important decision you'll ever make, these are the three questions you have to answer yes to know it's the right person. It's not in any priority order, because you have to answer yes to all three. Are you ready? Okay, now I got your attention. Okay, Number one, do you have the same meaningful life goals? And I don't mean, oh, we both want to get married and move to the suburbs and move in our garage and go north once a year and south once a year on the way for dinner. No. It's not what does your house look like, what does your house feel like? Not just do we want to have children, what values do we want to give our children? What a person does and where they do it can change. But a person's meaningful life goals and values, that has to be the same. When we say opposites attract, we don't mean values or goals. My day-to-day goals are very different than my husband's. But our life goals together, and I have to tell you, I realized early on when I was dating to get married that I'm a very idealistic person. I'm very idealistic, and I knew I wanted to do something for the Jewish people, and that's what I wanted to devote myself to. So, I dated the doctors and lawyers and captains, and I realized early on, I can't marry these guys. Why? For me. Again, you have to know what you need. Based on you. I had a girl who came up to me after a dating workshop. She was, I don't know if the guy I'm dating has the same meaningful life goals that I do because I don't know what my meaningful life goals are. It starts with you. Until you know who you are and where you're going, you don't know who to go with. So I remember, I remember dating an accountant and I'm thinking, I can't marry this guy. Why? For some people, and some people in this audience, being married to an accountant is the perfect guy for you to marry, but not based on who I am. What would I say to my husband if I married an accountant at the end of the day? So, honey, everything add up? So I knew I didn't just need a guy who was like, that's nice, honey, what you do for the Jewish people. I needed somebody who was going to do it with me. Like, for me, what I needed. Do you understand? All right. So do you have the same meaningful life goals? Number two, are you physically attracted to each other? This is a very, 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 very important part of a marriage. And not just for the first few years, everything loads, and the kids come in. No, this is actually supposed to be getting stronger in the marriage and not weaker. In the Torah, when it talks about a husband is intimate with his wife, and he knew her. The more knowledge, the more love. The more love, the more desire for each other. It's supposed to be getting stronger. And you're here tonight to support a cause that is almost a guarantee to keep this strong. You have to understand that on the JWRP trips, these women who are coming from not such strong Jewish backgrounds or knowledge, one of the things we do after we talk to them about marriage is we bring them to a mikvah. And most of them have never seen a mikvah in their lives, or they have a negative experience, or they have all these misconceptions. And we bring them, we try every year. Our first group of women came in 2009. We had 300 women, then we had 600 women, then we had 900, then we had 1,000, and the Israeli government came to us and partnered with us. And then we doubled our numbers, and we got Eastern Europe, and now we brought over 7,300 women from 24 countries. Okay? A contract with the government that, God willing, the next 2 years, another 7,000, so it's amazing. We bring them, so the first couple of years, we tried this mikvah and that mikvah to bring women to, and this mikvah, and then I finally said to my team there, find me the most beautiful mikvah in Israel, okay? I'll make the trip work. I want the most beautiful mikvah. So I don't know if you've ever been to Tzfat. There is the best of stunning, gorgeous, such a kiddush Hashem. The mikvah ladies there are like neshamas, that souls that need bodies to weigh them down, okay? They're just very, very special people. Very special, very funny. And the women are mesmerized. And I have to tell you, these women, many of them have never in their lives even imagined are so, but between going to the mikvah and the experience and the sisterhood and the learning and the Shabbos that we spend in the old city together, and it's just an unbelievable experience. So our data shows that 1 year after the trip, that 30% of the women are now keeping Torah so much fun. And you know what that can do. You know, when they hear this for the first time, this on again, off again, this honeymoon every month, this desire and build up for each other, they're like, why did no one tell me this? All right? This is such wisdom. And I have to tell you, we bring husbands now to Israel because the women are like, my husband is here, so my husband is here. So we have husband trips. Charlie Harari leads the trip, so those who know Charlie, I had to work on him for 4 years to do it. But he's like all in now, it's fantastic, and it's amazing. So we bring them to the same mikvah. And it was a big, we took a chance, and the mikvah was amazing to open up their doors, and the husbands sit there, and I speak, Charlie gives a whole talk to them about this subject, and I speak to them seriously like for 3 minutes. And I say to them that your wives come here, and they're very taken when we explain this mitzvah, and so many of them say to me, I would love to do this, but my husband's never going to go for this. And I told them, I said, guys, your wives come on the trip, they're amazing, and they share their lives with me, and they share their marriages with me. And I'm here to tell you, on behalf of your wives, that your wives are desperate for you to want them in every way, physically, emotionally, spiritually. And I'm telling you, the guys are just like. And on Shabbos, I always speak to them twice. I speak to them when I actually welcome them. I speak to them for 3 minutes at the mikvah. And then on Shabbos morning or Shabbos afternoon, I give them a talk on marriage. And the talk is called, What Your Wives Want You to Know. And I tell them that the Torah says that you have a job in marriage, guys. And your job is to make your wife happy. And I'm here to tell you how to do that. And they're literally like, just tell me, okay? I'll do it. They really don't know. So this is a very important part of marriage. And ladies, we're making mistakes in this area. And this is a very big deal for a guy, okay? And men and women often look upon this in a different way. I'm not going to go into a lot of details about it. But a great Rebbetzin once came to Toronto years ago. And I live in Washington, D.C. now. But when I was a young age wife in Toronto, so Rabbi Yaakov Weinberg Zitzal and his Rebbetzin came to Toronto, and she met with the young Rebbetzins, and she told us very strongly how important it is to always put your best foot forward, that you shouldn't take this aspect for granted in your marriage. And she said to us, so how do we look when we go out? How do you look when you go out? You dress up, right? You all look great tonight, ladies. Right? We dress up. And then when we go home, we dress down. So listen to the mistake. Our husbands are out there all day long interacting with women who went out, and they look great. And then he comes home to us. So it's not like my husband's going to come home and he sees me, you know, whatever, not so, and he's going to call up the basement for a gap. No, but this is chip away at the fragile mean laws called our marriages. And ladies, enough chips will cause a crack, and enough cracks will cause a break. So she told us the story. She said whenever her husband or Yaakov would drive up to the driveway, when she'd hear her husband come home, she would run to the bathroom, put on fresh lipstick, fix her hair, spray perfume, and go to the door to greet her husband. Night after night, this is what the kids saw. Their tante would drive up to the driveway, mommy would go, lipstick, perfume, hair, and greet their father. She said one night, she was very tired, and she fell asleep on the couch. And Rav Yaakov drove up to the driveway. And the kids panicked. Pati's home, and mommy's asleep on the couch. So she woke up, and you're sheer lipstick all over. It's a funny story, but listen to the message. Their kids saw, night after night, that their mother cared more about what their father thought of her than anyone else in the world. You can imagine what kind of marriages they have now that they've grown up. don't take this for granted. This is a very, very, very important part of a marriage. Okay. Third question. Third question is different for a woman than for a guy. Okay? Is this the one? Is this the one? Oh, by the way, if people here who are married, like me, and like a lot of you, if you answer no to one of these questions, do not go home and call up your husband and go, I knew it all along, and Lori just told me. This will be the last time they invite me back to Queens, all right? For those of us who are married, these are the three areas we have to put a lot of time and effort into. Nurturing our mutual goals and values. Making sure the physical attraction is going up and not down. Third question. Third question is different for a guy than for a girl. So when a girl comes to me, like, is this the one? So I go, okay, are the same people like both? Yes. Physical attraction? Yes. And then I'll look her in the eye without the guy in the room, and the third question to her, I will ask her, do you respect him? And she says, yes, without hesitating. This is it. But if I go, do you respect him? And she goes, yeah, I worry. It is a very, 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 very important thing for a guy. It's very important for a man that his wife respects him. He can be the CEO of a company and people are bowing down to him all day long. But if he comes home and he feels his wife doesn't respect him, it's not time. Why is it such a big deal for a guy that his wife respects him? I have no idea. I have my theories, ego of the society. Ladies, it doesn't matter why. It just is. It just is. I'm going to give you respect 101 now. You ready? This is basic, you're respecting your God. If you're not doing this, don't even come to me. I don't want to talk to you. Okay? This is basic, okay? Imagine, for whatever reason, Oprah Winfrey is coming to Queens and has picked your home to come to do an in-home interview. Okay? Okay, today, Oprah and the camera crew are coming. How's your house look? Perfect. How do you look? Perfect. Okay. You're on the phone with your best girlfriend waiting for Oprah and the camera crew. You go, oh my gosh, I'm coming back over here. Oprah's coming over here. I'm going to get you. This is great. Okay. Regular day, Oprah ain't coming. Regular day. You're on the phone with your best girlfriend. Your husband walks in. Ladies, when your husband comes home, get off the phone. And he should hear you say, oh my gosh, my husband's home, I gotta go. Click. What message are you sending to him? You are more important than anyone else at the end of this line. And it's true. There's a couple of exceptions. Number one, it's his mother. There you go. It's your mother. You're not on the phone, and you hear your husband come home. Grab your phone and go, oh my gosh, my husband's home, gotta go. Even when you go to the line, he loves it, okay? So some of you are sitting here, I know, and saying, you know what, I don't respect him, because he's like this, So I heard something amazing from an educator in Toronto, her name is Sherry Wines. She says, treat him like a man you respect, and he will become a man that you respect. If somebody you tremendously respect was coming over, or walked in, right? A great brother, your grandfather, somebody you tremendously respect, wouldn't you greet them at the door? Would you ask how they're feeling? Would you ask them if they want something to eat or something to drink? Treat him like a man you respect, and he will become a man that you respect. So that's the question we ask the girl. What do we ask the guy? Because what does a man need? A man needs to be respected. What does a woman need? A woman needs to be loved. A woman wants to be respected and needs to be loved, and a man wants to be loved but needs to be respected. So what do we ask the guy for the third question without the girl in the room? Will you be happy making her happy for the rest of your life? Every guy needs a job. His job is to make his wife happy. But you've got to have to take pleasure in making her happy. Okay? True story. Okay, because ladies, you've got to give him a break. You didn't marry Kreskin, a mind reader. Okay, he doesn't really know. I'm telling you, guys on the trip are like, just tell me, and I will make her happy. You're like, well, if I tell you, it won't mean anything. No, they don't know, okay? Thank God when your girls grow up and become teenagers, then your jewelry gets better, right? Because they can tell your husband, this is really what mommy wants, okay? But otherwise, you have to pretend, okay? So, true story, okay? My husband, bless him, okay? So you have to... I asked Rebbetzin Weinberg, I said, what's my job as a wife besides the obvious? She says, your job as a wife, his job is to make you happy. What's your job? To take a good guy and make him great. To make him great. And how do you make him great, I asked? How do you make him great? She said, by pointing out his mistakes in the very best way possible. And almost always, that's not by telling him you're making a mistake. Because he could take that as criticism. And that's not a way to build him, that's a way to break him. So how do you build him, but get him to become a greater person, okay? Okay, so I met my husband 30 years ago in Eretz Yisrael. And we met at the beginning of January, we got engaged at the end of January, and we got married in June, and now it's October, and it's my birthday. It's the first birthday we're celebrating as husband and wife. Okay, he remembered it was my birthday, you gotta give him that. And he hands me my present, he's all smiles, okay? What do you think my husband got me for the first birthday we're celebrating as husband and wife? A food processor. One woman in that audience said to me, she goes, I got a bathroom scale. And I realized he doesn't know he's a clueless, okay? So he must have heard me say when we set up house after all the wedding presents and showers, okay? I didn't get a food processor. I need a food processor. He's a man. It's not going to be for birthday, okay? So I said, thank you, honey. I needed a food processor. And I waited till we left the room, and I called my friend Esther. I go, Esther, Yaakov just gave me my birthday present. She goes, what'd you get? What'd you get? I said, a food processor. She goes, oh, you poor thing. I'll take care of it. Okay? So she told her husband, Ephraim, who worked with my husband, and they were married like a year before us, and he waited a couple of weeks and mentioned in passing that women like perfume and jewelry. So the next day, my Tommy had something to celebrate. He got me perfume. And the next time he got me perfume. The next time you got me perfume, I go, we only use a tiny bit, okay? Then you got the jewelry, and there's no turning back. So you have to point out his mistakes and help him to become great in a way that builds him and doesn't defeat him. And don't make the mistake that we often make, that we pour our time and love and affection and effort into our children because they need us. Your husband needs you too. He needs you more than you need him. What's my proof? People are married 40 years, 50 years, right? The woman dies, what does the guy do? Remarries in 2 seconds, okay? You're winding up, all right? The husband dies, what does the wife do? She goes on cruises with her girlfriend. Emotional relationship we will have in this life is with us. With us. For us, we can have a deep emotional relationship with the woman behind us at Walmart. We have girlfriends. But for the guys, you're it. For your husband, you're it. Don't bump him down the ladder when the kids come. He needs you too. All right. I will now skip, and I'm going to grab something, and we're going to end with a very important concept. This is from my Soul in the Afterlife talk. I asked our rabbi, Rabbi Noach Weinberg Zitzel, I said, you know, in the next world, in Olam Haba, I'm very practical. Who am I with? Who am I with for eternity? So he said, You have a connection to your parents in a certain relationship with them, and you have a connection to your children in a certain relationship with them, but the person you spend eternity with is your spouse. Now, some of you look happy and... When I learned this, I was so happy. And I remember going back to Toronto and saying to my friend Sandy, who has a very good marriage, I said, Sandy, I just learned we spend eternity with our husbands. She goes, my kids? I'm not with my kids. I go, Sandy, it makes so much sense. You give and you give and you give to your kids. And your success as a parent, if they grow up and leave you. You hope they live in the same city. You hope they pick up the phone. You hope they come to the Pesach Seder. But if your kids are 35 and living in your basement, something went wrong. Okay? But you give and you give. And you give to your spouse only so that he'll come closer to you. If you grew apart, something went wrong. What is this teaching us? Choose wisely. Work like crazy at your marriage. Ladies, it's just not for here. This is for eternity. Thank you very much.